You are now tuned into Sanya On Air. Welcome. You are now tuned into another fabulous edition of Sanya On Air. I'm your host, Sanya Hudson. And how do I start off each and every single show every week? I have another great show for you. I have two wonderful guests joining me today in the studio. Coming up shortly, I have Chef Zach Cara. Now, he is Masterchef Jr. He didn't win, but he was a semi-finalist. That's huge. So young and he can already cook. Puts me to shame. And he's also the Young Entertainer Award nominee for his YouTube cooking series. And he's also featured in a magazine. We're going to talk about that when he joins us. But coming on later on in the show, sexy, 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 and talented. That's the way to go. I have Timon, Durrett. He's an actor. You've seen him in Living Single. That was his breakout role. We've also seen him starring in Girlfriends, CSI, Like Mike, Barbershop. But recently, oh my gosh, he stars on OWN's Network's hit show, Queen Sugar. Great show. Great, great, great show. Before I continue, you know I always have to shout out my loyal listeners tuning in at 12:30 a.m. The Blaze in Georgia. Thank you all for joining the Sanya On Air family. Before we go any further, I just want to say rest in peace to Charlie Murphy. That was a huge loss to everyone. It was so unexpected. I didn't even know that he was battling leukemia. My heart and my condolences go out to his entire family. So, like I said, we have Chef Zach Cara that's going to be joining us first. So I don't want you to go anywhere, okay, because this is going to be another action-packed show, and it's also very entertaining because, you know, I like to have fun. I don't take myself too seriously. So whatever you do, I know it's kind of early, but if you want to grab a glass of wine or if you want to cook something in honor of Chef Zach, please feel free to do so, but don't go anywhere. So let's do this, Alan. Let's do a little two-step, you know, get the energy vibes flowing, and we'll be right back with Sanya On Air and Chef Zach. Stay tuned.
I worry about nothing. I am wearing a nada. I'm sitting pretty and impatient, but I know you gotta put in them hours. I'ma make it harder. I'm sending pick up the picture. I'ma get you fired. I know you're always on that night shift, but I can't stand these nights alone. And I don't need no explanation, 'cause baby, you're the boss at home. You don't gotta go to work, but you gotta work. You don't gotta go to work. And my body do the work. We can work from home. Oh. We can work. Let's put it in a motion. I'ma give you a promotion. I'll make it feel like a vacay. Turn the bed into an ocean. We don't need nobody. I just need your body. Nothing but sheets in between us. Ain't no getting off early. I know you're always on that night shift, but I can't stand these nights alone.
Welcome back to Sanya On Air. I don't know about you, but I love that song. And you know what I love even more? I love to eat. I'm such a foodie. It does something to me. Have you ever just watched someone cook? Just watch. And you just get into that two-step because you just can't wait to eat. I'm so excited. Like, my mouth is literally watering because we're about to speak with Chef Zach just about his amazing cooking abilities. He makes me feel kind of bad about myself, and that's no easy feat, but I feel bad because I'm just not the best cooker in the world, but I make do. So without any further ado, joining us is Chef Zach Cara. How are you, Chef? Hello, Zach? Zach, are you still there? Let's do this, Alan, because we are experiencing some technical difficulties. Let's go into a little commercial, and let's see if we can get him back on the line. We'll be right back with Sanya on Air. I don't know what happened. Live radio, people. It happens. It really does. Do we have anything queued up? Okay, so let's get that started so that we can make sure that he's coming right back to us.
Your business okay. To the next level? Do you want to network and expand your client base? Are you looking to attend empowering seminars at a discounted rate? Do you want to build strategic partnerships? Are you a budding or new entrepreneur? Do you need solutions to your small business issues? If you answered yes to all or most of the above, then the New American Chamber of Commerce is the right chamber for you. Join today. Membership has many advantages. Visit www.mynacc.org. That's www.mynacc.org. Are you looking for a chamber to help you take your business to the next level? Do you want to network and expand your client base? Are you looking to attend empowering seminars at a discounted rate? Do you want to build strategic partnerships? Are you a budding or new entrepreneur? Do you need solutions to your small business issues? If you answered yes to all or most of the above, then the New American Chamber of Commerce is the right chamber for you. Join today. Membership has many advantages. Visit www.mynacc.org. That's www.mynacc.org.
Welcome back to Sanya on Air. We're going to try to play that song again because we need to get Chef Zach back online because I'm really interested in speaking with him. Stay tuned to Sanya on Air.
I'm sitting pretty impatient, but I know you gotta put in them hours. I'ma make it harder. I'm sending pic after picture. I'ma get you fired. I know you're always on that night shift, but I can't stand these nights alone. And I don't need no explanation, 'cause baby, you're the boss at home. You don't gotta go to work, but you gotta put in work. You don't gotta go to work. Let my body do the work. We can work tomorrow. Oh, oh, oh. We can work tomorrow. Oh, oh, oh. Let's put it in a motion. I'ma give you a promotion. I'll make it feel like a vacay. Turn the bed into an ocean. We don't need nobody. I just need your body. Nothing but sheets in between us. Ain't no getting off early. I know you're always on that night shift, but I can't stand these nights alone. And I don't need no explanation, 'cause baby, you're the boss at home. You don't gotta go to work. But you gotta put in work. You don't gotta go to work. And my body do the work. We can work tomorrow.
Oh, yeah. Girl, gotta work for me. Can you make a clap? No hands for me. Take it to the ground, pick it up for me. Look back at it all, I'm for me. Put in work like my time, she ride it like a 63. I'ma buy a new Celine. Let her ride in the foreign with me. Ooh, she the babe, I'm her boo. And she down to break the rules. Ride it down, she gon' go. I'm gon' choose, she finesse. I fight boom, she take that. Put in overtime on your body.
You ain't gotta go away. No. Work. But you gotta do it.
Welcome back to Sanya On-Air, just like I promised. You know, this is a live show. Things happen, but what do? We just keep it rolling. So without any further ado, I want to bring you Chef Zach Cara. How are you, Chef? Zach? Are we going through the technical difficulties again with the show? This is amazing. Zach, are you there? I don't know what's going on. I'm trying to contact his PR person. He's called back twice. This is what happens in live radio, I'm telling you. So for all of you tuning in who aspire to be radio hosts or podcast hosts, and you ask, you know, what's the biggest lesson that I learned? I've learned how to land on my feet in spite of the wind and the storms that blow. So this is what we are going to do. I'm going to just talk a little bit about what's going on in the world. You know, we always do hot topics. There's a lot going on, as it always is. You know, I'm reading something right now about Candy Burris. I know you know Candy Burris from the legendary R&B group Escape, and she's currently on The Real Housewives of Atlanta. Well, I don't know about you, but for the past season, I've been looking at Candy like, it looks like you've had some work done. Shabamboo. You know, and she was not owning that before. Well, now she is admitting that she has had plastic surgery after giving birth to her one-year-old son. I knew it all along, because let me tell you something. Right after Candy had her son, she was snatched to the gods. Did you see her waistline? I mean, you could really, really see her waistline. Now, I'm a mom myself, so I know about the experience of giving birth to a child, and the snatchback game, it takes a while. You know, after you have the baby, you might be a little, but you are not going to be totally snatched. So she revealed that she got breast implants. That's not it. Come on, that's all she's owning up to. I'm not believing this. Just breast lifts. I'm saying, and allegedly, just as a woman who's had a baby, not only did she have the breast lift, but she also had some sort of liposuction. I'm telling you, that waist was snatched, and there is nothing that a waist trainer can do that will give you that hourglass figure after you had a baby so soon. Come on. So, Alan, were we able to get Chef back on the line? He's going to call back in a little bit. So, yeah, like I said, this is what happens in live radio. Now, speaking of Candy Burris, you know that she is close friends, with Tiny. You know, she's also a member of the legendary rap group Escape, and she's married to rapper T.I. And I've been reporting on this story for quite some time. Remember, they were saying that they were getting back together, and that's what this new season of T.I. and the Family Hustle was going to be about. Well, I don't know if you've seen the interviews or heard the interviews, but it's not happening. They are definitely going to get a divorce. But what I don't want to do is divorce from this show, because like I said, I'm married to this show for life. And like I said, I'm a foodie at heart. So to be able to talk to Chef Zach, I'm totally, totally excited, because maybe he can kind of up my cooking game. Zach, are you there on the line?
I'm still here, yep.
The technical difficulties of live radio. Let's get started. So how old are you?
So I'm 14 years old, and I turn 15 next month.
You're 14 years old and you cook like that? Your birthday is in May, so that makes you what sign?
Honestly, I keep forgetting. I think I'm a Taurus. I don't know why. I'm really into that stuff. So everyone's like, oh, you're this and that. I'm like, I don't even know what that is.
That's the first time I've heard that before. No one knows. Yeah, everyone knows what their sign is. But I'm very proud of you. I just learned that you were featured in Entrepreneurial Chef magazine. Tell us a little bit about that.
I was. So I got this awesome opportunity from this magazine, and it's just such a cool magazine, because they give it out for free to everyone in cooking schools across America. So it's just really inspiring. And they had Robert Irvine, Chef Art Smith, and just a bunch of like really cool, influential chefs there. So it's a really awesome magazine.
And to be featured in it, and you're 14 years old, so I'm sure that your counterparts, everyone else who was in the magazine, they're nowhere near your age. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's true. I was probably the youngest person in there by far.
So how do you manage to stay humble just being in the presence of legendary chefs and being featured in magazines of this magnitude? How do you stay humble?
Well, I think I just try to be who I am. I mean, I'm never going to be the super cocky or just bragging type of guy, because that's not who I am. I'm always like this really, I try to be like this really nice person, and are just like kind of like this goofy kid around the house too. So it's kind of just who I am, really.
I hear that. So how did you learn how to cook? Tell me that, because I'm still trying to learn, and I'm in my 40s.
So I started to watch some of the kids' cooking shows. I still remember it. My sister downloaded it on her tablet while we were out shopping, and I got bored, and she showed it to me. So we started to watch it, and then I was really inspired by some of these kids, and then I thought, well, if they're cooking, why can't I? And the funny thing is, I had zero interest whatsoever in cooking before. So I asked my mom if she could start to teach me how to cook. She didn't really think much of it.
Mm-hmm.
So she was teaching me how to cook for the next couple months, but then I decided to enroll myself in an online cooking school and teach myself from there. And then next thing you know, I was asking my mom for whole chickens so that way I can like break it down and stuff. And it was really funny.
Wait a minute. Go back. Because like I said, I'm not the best cook in the world. There's an online cooking school? Are you serious?
Yeah. So it's an online cooking school and called Ruby. And then they have like instructional videos and all these sort of tests and stuff and like recipes that they would make you go do.
Really?
And I would just. And then I eventually became part of my schoolwork because I'm homeschooled.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just like going through them, and then one day it'd be, hey, you got to break down a whole chicken, or you got to like make your own stock, or learn how to cook a fish, or make a vinaigrette, or like all this basic like knife skills and everything.
So basic? That sounds very. That's
culinary school.
You're like, that's basic stuff. That sounds very difficult to me. You're like, make vinaigrette. I'm like, what? You don't buy that from the store? Like, what's going on? What was the first dish that you made?
Well, the first dish that I made, well, the thing is, when I started cooking, I did something very simple, and that was just scrambled eggs with vegetables. So
okay.
I think for like the next month, I would wake up every morning and make that.
Mm-hmm.
And then it came to a point where my parents were just like, yeah, we kind of don't want to eat that. We're kind of getting sick of that.
Right.
So, but apart from that, like one of the first dishes I made that I created myself were probably on MasterChef. And one of my favorite ones was a pan-seared bronzino with a celery rack puree, sauteed peas with an onion beet marmalade. So that was one of my favorite dishes I made on the show.
Wow. Let me tell you something, Zach. I'm truly impressed. You have no idea. Like, my family gets on me all the time about not cooking, and I'm just like, this 14-year-old is putting me to shame. Like, you have no idea. So let's talk about MasterChef Jr. a little bit. How did you get to be on that show? That's huge. And like I said, I just want to remind my listeners, he's 14 years old. How did you become a part of the show?
So when I was 11, I actually tried to audition for 2 and 3, but then I just never really got around to even doing it. But then when 4 came around, there was open calls for, like, to go in there and do, like, an open call. And then me and my mom, we just set out to, like, get that done. So we flew to Phoenix, and there was about 600 to 700, 800-plus kids.
Wow.
And they told me to get there at a certain time. I think I waited for, like, almost 3 hours just to go in for, like, my 10-minute interview type thing. And then apart from that, it was just, like, a really long process.
Mm-hmm.
And then eventually I somehow ended up getting on the show.
Wow. So when you auditioned to be on the show, I'm assuming that you were still in school. Because you say you're homeschooled now. So how did that change? You know, how did your friends, your counterparts, your peers in school treat you when they were like, oh my gosh, she's going to be on MasterChef Junior? How did that happen?
Well, I've been homeschooled for a really long time now. So I was still actually homeschooled while I was auditioning for a MasterChef.
Okay.
But I still get, but I occasionally get recognized on the street and stuff and take a picture, so it's pretty cool.
That sounds pretty cool. Now, how do you feel about being in a part of an industry that's still often reserved for women like myself, even though I put other women to shame with my cooking skills? How do you feel about being in an industry that's often reserved for just women?
Well, honestly, there's actually a lot of boys and men starting to cook, or guys starting to cook a lot more. And one thing that I've really been fortunate was the Orlando chef community have been truly just very opening, and like they've treated me like one of their own. Like they've offered to like teach me how to cook inside their kitchens during like services, and like they've let me use their kitchens for like photo shoots anytime I need to, basically. So they've been super welcoming, and it's just been so much fun.
That sounds like a lot of fun. And cause, you know, and I asked you that, and I knew what your answer was going to be, because I just want my listeners to understand that cooking isn't just reserved for women.
It's not.
And, you know, we need to really broaden our horizons and just understand that this is an open playing field for men and women. So kudos to you for clearing that up. Now, being on the show and being featured in these magazines, how has your life changed? Because I'm sure it has. It's not the same life that you had when you were 5 years old. How has life changed for you and also your family?
Things have been just busy, but in a good way. You know, I'm also starting to audition for some acting TV shows.
Really?
I like stumbled upon that. Yeah. Because one thing that kind of helped me being more comfortable on camera was actually going to some acting lessons. And what I would do is my acting coach was like pretend to cook a dish, do like a demo. And then I noticed all like these things that was like all like these nervous twitches that I would have on camera. And then I stumbled into acting. So that's something I've been doing too. But my life has just been really, really busy, because every time I think I start to like get a chill break for like a couple days, then another incredible opportunity pops up. Like I just did something for the Make-A-Wish, a walk here in Orlando about a month ago, and then I went to LA for the YEA Awards.
Uh-huh.
So everything is I'm so happy for this, because everything just keeps coming and coming along.
So you just mentioned the YEA Award. Is that because of your YouTube series? Was that the award for?
Yeah, so I got nominated again this year for my YouTube series called Cooking Up Life, which was kind of like a combo to my cookbooks. I released a 6-recipe cookbook with the 6 instructional, like fun videos on how to make them, and posted them on my YouTube.
Wow, 6-recipe cookbook. I'm writing that down because I need to go get it. Now, I need some help, Zach. I really do.
Yeah.
I am a very busy mom, career woman, and I often don't have time to cook. What is a quick dish that anybody can make that is flavorful, fulfilling, and fun? And takes, it takes under 30 minutes. If it takes over 30 minutes, like, I can't do it. Something real quick.
Well, if you're trying to be, like, really healthy.
Yeah, I'm healthy. And I don't eat meat.
Don't eat meat. Okay,
no.
Perfect. Do you eat fish?
Yeah, sometimes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, perfect. So one of the recipes for my cookbook, because the way I did it was that they're just very simple and easy recipes. So there's too easy, too medium, too hard.
Mm-hmm.
And then one of the recipes is a peanut oven salmon with a cabbage slaw and just a sauce around it. It's so easy to make, and it's really healthy, because all you do is you make the peanut sauce, put it in your salmon inside some tinfoil, cook it in the oven for 20 minutes, shred up some cabbage with a couple other things, and it's just really simple, delicious, and easy to make.
That sounds delicious. You have no idea. Like, I was licking my lips here in the studio. This recipe, is it in your cookbook, or can I find it on your YouTube series? It's in the book?
Yeah, it's in the book, but then you can see how to make it on my YouTube page.
Oh, I'm going to go
all,
there.
All, like, the measurements and everything are inside my cookbook.
And your YouTube channel, what is it so that we can go to it and learn how to cook? Or am I just talking to myself?
My YouTube channel is just my name. It's Zach Cara, Z-A-C-K-A-R-A.
Okay, well, definitely. And your 6-recipe cookbook, how can we purchase that? Where can we go?
Well, you can purchase it on Amazon for $2.99. I didn't want to put it for, you know, like $15,
$20.
Right. 6 recipes. But it's just like my first cookbook. Hopefully many more to come.
Mm-hmm.
But I was just, a cookbook's been a huge dream of mine since I started cooking. So it's just really surreal. And I'm really, really happy the way it turned out.
Oh, wow.
And it's an awesome read.
For $2.99 and you get 6 recipes, you have me sold. So I'm going to be purchasing the book. I'm going to go to your YouTube channel to figure out how to do the peanut oven salmon with cabbage slaw. I'm going to be looking out for your acting. Do you plan to write any more books?
Well, I hope maybe I'll write another cookbook this time. Hopefully at least more than 6 recipes, maybe 20, 30. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to try to I'm definitely going to be writing one soon, hopefully.
Wow. We're 14 years old and 6 recipe cookbook. You have your YouTube channel, Masterchef Jr., features in magazine, award-winning chef. And once again, 14 years old. Zach, thank you so much for being a guest on Sanya On Air. We wish you continued success,
thank
we'll be looking out for your continued growth. Enjoy the rest of your day.
For sure. Thank you so much for having me. Have a great day.
You too. Bye-bye. So there you have it. I'm real. He really put me to shame. I know. Let me tell you something. This is live. I was sweating. I was about to have an emotional breakdown. You know, I keep it 100 on this show because I was just like, oh my gosh, we got to get him back on the line. I'm trying to email his PR person. We're calling. This is live radio, and this is a total representation of what life is. Life will just happen in a snapshot of a millisecond. And what you do and how you react, you know, it can kind of dictate what your next 5 minutes or 1 hour or the rest of your life will look like, will feel like, will sound like. So take these little, let's say, snafus, if that's even a word, and use it as a lesson to always be on your A game. Always be ready. So, like I said, just coming up later on in the show, Timon, Durrett. Oh my gosh. Queen Sugar is one of my favorite shows. Oprah Winfrey and the OWN Network has really stepped it up. Really. I remember when Oprah Winfrey first launched the OWN Network. And, you know, there was very little that we can watch. If we missed it, it definitely wasn't on demand. But, you know, now these wonderful shows that's on OWN, just like Queen Sugar with Timon, Durrett, you can watch them on demand. You know, takes about 1 or 2 days now, and it's on demand for you to watch. So I'm super, super excited to talk about not only his career, but just him being a handsome man. Don't put a handsome man in the room with me. Oh, my God. I'm just keep it there. You know how I get, Alan. You know how I get. So let's do this, Alan. Let's play another commercial song. And when we return, we'll be joined by Timon, Durrett, who is one of the stars of the OWN Network's Queen Sugar. We'll be right back with Sanya On Air. Stay tuned.
Woo! Don't hit me too hard. Oh, yeah. Girl, 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 girl. you care. Good enough for you? Oh, maybe you just look too good for me. But don't sweat yourself. I'm strong.
Welcome back to Sanya On-Air. I hope you got your two-step, and I hope that you did not leave and you were dancing wherever you are, because I was surely dancing in the studio. I'm so excited to be talking to my next guest, and I know that you are all uber excited. You've been hitting me up on my social media accounts. Those of you who know me well enough to have my email, you've been emailing me like, can we go into the studio with you today? And I'm like, nope. I want them all to myself. I'm a huge fan of Queen Sugar on the OWN Network. And like I said, my next guest, Timon, he's also starred in Living Single. Oh my gosh. CSI. Oh my gosh. Like Mike. Oh my gosh. Talk about longevity, especially for a black actor. We don't even want to put race in this. Just for an actor in general, longevity. So without any further ado, Timon, how are you?
I'm good. How's it going?
It's going well. We just had a little bit of technical difficulties in the studio today. But other than that, you know, now that you're joined in on the show, it's perfect. Now,
fantastic.
Now, you play a lot of characters on television over the years. And I don't know if it's just us, you know, who can't seem to get past the sexiness of you. Has that been a hindrance? Has the industry tried to typecast you? Because you're good looking. Let's just put it out there. Have you been typecasted?
You know, I can't say that I have just yet. I do play some similar characters. I typically play a well-to-do, clean-cut, well-dressed guy.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, sometimes the character is a little controversial and contentious and not the most likable person, which is a little fun to me. I like playing the quote-unquote bad guy because, you know, the conflict brings, it exudes a little bit more emotion
from
the viewers. And, you know, I just like to, you know, convey a very true message to people, whether I'm playing a bad guy or a good guy. So, but I don't, as far as being typecast, I don't know just yet. I didn't come this far just to come this far. I think I got some more stuff coming, so I can't say that I'm a typecast just yet.
I hear you. Now, you talked about, you know, just controversy, and your role on Queen Sugar, it's very controversial. It's a lot of emotions we're drawn into your character. Is it difficult for people out on the street to separate your character from the real life you?
At times it has been, not just with Davis West on Queen Sugar, but with other characters that I played. On Single Ladies, I played Quinn Davis, another very, you know, not the most likable guy.
Right.
When I was in the stage play with Tyler Perry's production, The Marriage Counselor, I was a monster. And some people, from all those these different roles I played, these less than desirable characters, sometimes there are people in public who have shown a bit of disdain for me personally.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you an example. We were in Grand Rapids, Michigan. I just finished up a show of The Marriage Counselor. Very great crowd, very high energy.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a lot of emotion. You can feel it. And I was outside getting in the van, had to go back to the hotel. And a gentleman walked up and he shook my hand. He said, "Man, I really enjoyed your performance." I'm like, "Thank you." And right then his wife grabbed me and said, "No, baby, we don't talk to him. Let's go."
No.
And they walked away from me. And I was like, what is going on? But, you know, to me, it's a compliment to my work because
if I can
extract that kind of emotion from you or to prompt such an action because of how you feel emotionally attached to the character or detached from the character or whatever.
You've done your job.
I feel like yes, exactly. Exactly.
Oh, so, my gosh.
It's not all bad.
Uh-huh. Now, I know that, I'm not positive, but I'm a little bit sure there were other actors up against the same role that you secured on Queen Sugar. Can you tell us, like, what other actors were vying for the same role that you got?
A few, I forget some of the names. I believe there were some NBA players.
Really?
That's what I was told. I didn't really focus on who it was. I know there was one name
whose
work I really respect. Toby Bell.
Okay.
And I love that guy's acting. I've always looked and said, I want to play his brother on TV because we kind of look similar.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't really get into how many people were up for the role. But I did hear from other friends of mine, actors and actresses, whom I've recently befriended over the past maybe 4 or 5 years,
mm-hmm.
who I used to watch on television when I was younger, even before I was in the industry. And you know, we became friends because of common mutual friends and things like that. And they told me that they couldn't even get in to read for it. It was such a buzz about it before we even had done anything, because I think the tandem of Oprah Winfrey and Ava DuVernay really, really attracted a lot of attention. And then after the first season, you know, it just, you know, everything came to fruition. All the expectations were met as far as I can see.
Yeah.
But as far as how many guys were up for the role.
You're not sure.
I don't really know, but I heard it was a growing number as word got out.
So if you could play any role on television or in film, what is your ideal role?
I won't even just say I want to be. I will be an action figure.
Wow. I can see that.
I've had this fascination with like high action. And, you know, I want to be able to go and say, oh, I got to train with this master martial artist or this person and like get beat up for work for like 2 months before we start filming and things like that. I love action and suspense. Like, then, you know, like the Bourne Identity and things
like that.
I love stuff like that. The Marvel movies are becoming more and more exciting.
Yes, they are on Netflix. Yes, they are.
Yeah, you know, just all of these different things. Why, you know, I want to play someone kind of intimidating and scruffy and grungy, but at the same time, you know, excuse my language, a badass.
Right.
Know?
There's like, nothing wrong with that.
Like, yeah, the guy that could get, you know, this. Yeah, I just like that kind of stuff. Like Will Smith, he can be kind of funny and quirky, but also be the hero.
Yeah.
I think it would be exciting to do something like that. And I'm pushing for it. I thought it's going to happen. I'm telling you.
I see it coming, too. So the end of the spectrum or the opposite of the spectrum from that, would you play a role where, let's say, you had a love interest who was a man and it became very sexual? Would you do that?
I mean, that may be challenging for me. I just, you know, for me, it's a matter of what the material is. And, you know, I'm not sure because that's not who I am. I like to be a lot of who I am in the character,
I hear
but
you.
Not. It's difficult to explain how I see the characters that I play. I like to look at them as something that's already constructed. It's been given to me, but I can make it my own. And so I'll give you an example. When you're an artist, many artists don't make their own canvases.
Right.
You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But if someone gives you that canvas, it's up to you or that medium, whatever the medium is. And it depends on if you're comfortable with that medium. If someone said, hey, we're going to give you some charcoal and some pastel and some pencils and some nice gray paper.
Mm-hmm.
I can use that. But if someone says, hey, we're going to give you some spray cans and a brick wall, I don't really know what to do with that because that's not my forte. I know some people can really do that.
Right.
But for me, I'm not sure if I could, if I can't inject a lot of reality into it. I'm not sure if I do that.
That's understandable. Well, you know, let's talk about you as a kid and who you aspired to become. When you were a kid, did you know that you wanted to be an actor? And when did that happen, that realization that you wanted to be a professional actor?
As a child, I always had these stories. I remember my fifth and sixth grade teacher he taught the school body was where certain teachers could teach the same children the following year because of the numbers of children and stuff like that. So Mr. Victor Rigoni, he was my fifth and sixth grade teacher.
Wow, you and still remember his name. That's cool.
I remember his name. He's very stern with me, but he was very understanding. He saw that I had this flair for storytelling and these elaborate, fantastic, you know, adventures that I talk about. And I used to have a fascination with puppets and how ventriloquists and puppeteers can make these puppets come to life. So I got one as a gift, and I would bring it to school. And he made a deal with me. I would always bring it out at the end of class.
You know, that's kind of weird, though, right?
it's
kind of weird.
I was a different kind of kid. But long story short, he ended up making a deal with me. If I did my work well and I got a certain amount of grades, he would allow me to do a puppet show for 30 minutes on Fridays, 30 minutes before we got out of school. And I started to develop this fascination for storytelling, which, you know, it translates into my acting.
Right.
Because I love to convey a clear message. So I knew early on that I love storytelling, but it wasn't until the 1990, early 90s, when I really expressed to my parents how I wanted to be on television. But none of us, we didn't know what, we didn't know the first thing of how
right,
to do it.
Right.
And my mother heard a radio advertising for extra roles and other Navy featured extra roles in a made for television movie called There Are No Children Here, starring Oprah Winfrey.
Wow.
And that was my very first acting job ever.
Wow. That's huge.
I got the little role, I was on set, I was hooked, and I knew that day.
From that moment on, the rest is history. Wow. Yeah. Now let's get a little personal. Are you married?
I'm not married.
You have kids?
I do have children, but I am single as a dollar bill. So, yeah.
So how do you feel about marriage? Like, do you want to be married one day?
I don't see it right now.
Me either.
I've had a lot of times in my life where everything was just a huge chunk of right now, a lot of stuff that had to be done right now. And now that I'm able to get other aspects of my life together, you know, all the peaks and the valleys, sometimes it would seem like there were more valleys than peaks. And now that I'm able to get some things together, I just have to make sure that if I am going to become betrothed to a young lady, that
right.
I want to be the best me that I can be when I present myself to her.
So because what will that woman look like when she finally comes along and you're in a place to accept that, listen, you know, I may be on the path to marriage? What will that ideal woman look like to you? And I'm not talking about, you know, brown hair. I'm talking about her inner soul. Like, what must she possess?
Great energy and a great intellect. I'm very attracted to brilliant minds and just energy and great energy. By great energy, I mean being real. I'll give an example. I do not expect a parakeet to act like a house cat.
You better do the analogy.
By that I mean be who you are. And if I like you for who you are, accept that. If I love you and accept you for who you are, accept that. I want a woman who is the most genuine with herself, because there is for everyone on the planet, there is one person who you cannot lie to.
That's true.
And that is yourself. And if you're being true to you, it resonates. There's a frequency and an intention that follows that frequency if you are being true to yourself. You can be tall, you can be short, you can be dark, you can be light, you can have long, curly brown hair, you can have kinky black hair,
right.
You can have the big, prettiest lips, you can have small little lips, cheekbones, hips, thighs. I like the whole package of a good woman, and there's no one cookie cutter formula or look for that. But I will say, for my presence, it will be a sister.
I heard
or
that.
Black.
You better have said that.
and that's just, you know, that's my preference. And I don't, you know, if someone wants to say, well, that's reverse racism, you know, I can just cut you down with all that and say I can't be racist because I don't control the infrastructure of society the way certain people
affect
my people. So I prefer what I'm used to and what I like and what I've come to enjoy and the opposite sex, and that is black women.
I love it. So what's one thing about you that the everyday person wouldn't know? One thing about you that people don't know?
I used to be terrified of butterflies.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. I used to be terrified of worms. So I get it.
I can hang with a worm. I can kick it with a spider, a wasp. A dragonfly didn't bother me. I don't know what it was. There was something about those butterflies.
Really?
The way they move. It freaked me out. I didn't like the way they
move. You said the way they move.
Yeah, the way they move. I didn't like it. I didn't like
wow.
it.
Wow.
Put them on their fingers and stuff. I'm like, and then they land and then they move all slow on you. And they flutter in your face. I'm like, no. I don't like that.
Yeah, the fluttering, they have ulterior motives. I get it. Are you still afraid of butterflies, though, or no?
No, they don't bother me.
Okay.
I've long since overcome that phobia. But
cool.
It back when I was in grade school, I said, man, you couldn't get me within 100 feet of them things. I did not like them at all.
And wait, you grew up in Chicago, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Chicago and afraid of butterflies. Look at that.
I'd rather have a pit bull get loose than have a butterfly get in me, man.
That's funny. I love it, though, because it softens you. It softens you a lot because we talked about, you know, some of the controversial roles that you've had. And just to know that, you know, years ago you were scared of butterflies, that's very cute. Let's get back to Queen Sugar, though. When can we expect the next season? Because we're, like, on pins and needles waiting.
It was just announced the other day.
What?
We have, another two-day premiere, June 20th and 21st.
Get out. I'll be tuned in.
Yeah, it's only a couple months away, a little over 2 months away, so.
Wow. Can you give us, like, a little sneak peek? Like, what can we expect, especially from your character? Because we're kind of mad at you, okay?
I will say that there will be more of what was there last season, and there will be more new stuff this season. Especially with the even more female directors at the helm.
Oh.
And I got to tell you, man, look, anybody that doubts the incredible, precious, and powerful nature of women in film, y'all tripping.
I know.
These women are bringing, it's not just
they are.
Black women, it's,
uh-huh.
it's the women, period.
No yeah, they're changing the narrative, and that's what I love. They're at the forefront of the conversation.
That's right, but... I mean, as far as season two, I can't give anything away.
Right.
But there is more to come, and the you know, the Queen Sugar saga continues. It's some good stuff coming, and we're not even halfway done yet. So it's some good stuff coming.
I love it. I love every single character on there because their story is just so unique and it's so deep. It's multi-layered. Mm-hmm. It's not simple. And like I said, it makes us want to know more. So we will definitely be tuned in to season two. And you said that's going to be in June, correct?
Mm-hmm. June 20th and 21st.
Wow. Well, thank you so much for being a guest on Sanya On Air. We will be tuned in to season two, and much continued success to you. And once again, just thank you. Thank you so much.
No problem. Thank you for having me. It's good to talk to you.
Take care.
All right. You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
So there you have it. That's so cute. That's so cute. Like, what man talks about he's scared of butterflies? You know, that's about the transparency and the keeping it real on Sanya On Air. And this is one thing that I love about my guests. They love to have the conversation with me. And there's never a question or a situation that is too intense where they're just like, listen, I'm not answering that question. Or listen, I'm not going back on that show. I love the fact that Sanya On Air has been able to grow because of guests like Timon. Honest, open, engaging, humorous, and real. One thing, well, there was a few things that resonated with me. Just having a support system. So when he was a kid and, you know, he realized that he had a knack for storytelling and, you know, just a little interest, a little light went off that he wanted to pursue acting and the support of his mom, who just heard a commercial and said, okay, I'm going to take you to this audition. And he got it. So, you know, I say all that to say, because not everyone has support in their lives. And I just encourage all of you to, you don't have to have a whole team behind you. You get one good person to ride or die.
with you, to have your back. Loyalty means a lot. So, like I said, you know, we will definitely be tuned in to season 2 of Queen Sugar so that we can watch the ever so handsome and talented, because it's not just about a handsome or a pretty face. Gotta have something to keep you in the room, okay? So, Timon, once again, just thank you for being on the show. So this is what we're going to do, Alan. We're going to wrap up, right? The show is over. It went by quick. You know, I love to talk to you all. I live for being in the studio and talking to you all. I really do, because I just feel your energy, all of you who are tuning in, like we're friends, you know, like we are just having a social gathering of the week to just love on one another. I wish everyone who is tuning in today and each and every single week the best that life has to offer. And the reason why I bring these guests on the show is so that really, I really want to give you a blueprint. I want to give you something tangible to hear, something tangible to feel in your heart, your minds, and your souls. So that's the end of today's Sanya on Air, but we'll be back. So let's just dance to Push It by Salt and Pepper. Mwah! I'll be back. Sanya On Air. Bye-bye.
Listen, man, if you never came up to Sanya On Air Radio, you're missing out, or you're just not that type of person that ain't out here trying to work. It's been a pleasure coming all the way to New York City, man. The hospitality was good. I even got some free water today in the little cup. But the interview was well spoken. And if you ever been some interviews, blah, she know what she's talking about. Her correction is on point. It was just a good event. It was a good experience, man. I just appreciate her allowing me to come and talk about my new movie. The engineer, man, was cool. He was bugging out. And the music was pretty good. They got good music choices. So please, keep supporting Sanya On Air Radio.